Welcome everyone, and thank you for joining us tonight for Failure as a Tool, a discussion on GenderFail’s and Anthology on Failure 2, Building on Our Failed States. My name is Lily Hearn Foundation, and I'm the Programs Manager at Q. Before I introduce our speakers, I have a few housekeeping notes. First, this panel is being recorded, so please turn off your video and rename yourself using an alias if you'd like to protect your privacy. Please keep your mic muted throughout the talk to ensure the best audio experience for everyone. Live captions are available tonight. If you click on the CC closed caption button at the bottom of your screen and select show subtitles, you'll be able to view these. Finally, there will be a short Q&A period after the discussion during which you may type questions into the chat for any of our speakers. If you'd prefer to ask a question yourself, please indicate that when you submit your question or use the raise hand function and one of us can unmute you. Tonight, we are lucky to be joined by many brilliant speakers, thinkers, and makers. Be Oakley is a writer, facilitator, publisher, and the founder of GenderFail, a publishing and programming initiative began in 2015 that seeks to encourage projects that foster an intersectional queer subjectivity. Kira Wisniewski serves as the executive director of Art and Feminism, an international community that works collectively and collaboratively to close the information gap about gender, feminism, and the arts on the internet. Shawn Escarciga, he, they, is an artist, arts administrator, and the founder and co-organizer of the NYC Low-Income Artist and Freelance Relief Fund, alongside Nadia Tikulskar. Anthea Black and Jessica Whitbread are publishers of the HIV Howler, Transmitting Art and Activism. Anthea is a Canadian artist, writer, and cultural worker based in San Francisco and Toronto. Jessica is a queer activist and artist based in Kyrgyzstan and Toronto. Kamra Sadia Hakim, they, them, is an occupied Munsee Lenape territory-based futurity artist using their Black trans body as a portal to the futures needed now. They are the founder of Activation Residency and devoted to the power of imagination and love as the answer. Before I hand over this event to our speakers, I wanted to say a few words about its evolution. Be Oakley and I began discussions about this panel in the summer of 2019, which feels like it was 15 years ago by now. We wanted to host a book release and panel discussion for the second anthology on failure that they were planning to publish in the spring of 2020. We picked a date in early May, hoping to host something that was equal parts discussion and celebration. When the pandemic finally shut down New York City in March, we naively thought we'd be able to postpone until we were able to meet in person again. In April, Bea asked me to contribute a text to the anthology, which I was honored to do. At that point, we still hoped we could host this event in person, thinking it might be possible towards the end of 2020. And here we are at the end of 2020, on November 12th, a day when more than 142,000 coronavirus cases and 65,368 hospitalizations have been reported in the US alone. In this country where 241,000 virus-related deaths have been reported, the most of any country in the world, and a number which continues to disproportionately affect communities of color. The in-person days are still very far away, but despite the stark numbers that show us that no matter who holds office this January, there is much work to be done, I believe that the documents of mutual aid, solidarity, and world building that are collected in this anthology and on this panel serve as lasting reminders of the power of collective care, love, and labor as those who recognize the failures around us work from the ruins to create solutions and build the worlds that we want to see. And now it is my pleasure to introduce Be Oakley.
Thank you so much for everything, for that amazing introduction. And I just first off want to say also thank you and also Q for, well, really you for especially the budget. Everyone is being paid here tonight, which I would never want to do any, I would never ask anyone to do any programming that's not compensated. So I think in total, Q is putting up almost $1,000 worth of fees for this. And I'm just so grateful. And thank you so much for paying all of us to be here and to talk. So I'm gonna share my screen now and get this rolling. Great. So I just want to say just a couple words about GenderFail to start off. I started GenderFail in 2015, and it's done just by me. I have help here and there, but also talking about like the ethics of paying folks. I, you know, don't have a budget to do this project besides the sales of my publication. So I kind of make everything with this project within the means of GenderFail. One second. Great. So I just want to first talk briefly about the first anthology. So this is a series of projects that I've been working on since I finished grad school in the summer of 2018. So this first anthology really focused on failure as a catalyst of creative production through individual artists. So I, and also it was an investigation into what GenderFail means, because when I was working on this project and naming this project, I didn't put too much thought about exactly what GenderFail meant, besides, you know, just kind of questioning and continuing and still kind of embracing and figuring out my non-binary identity. So this first project was really special. And one of the catalysts for this project was a work that I did in graduate school called My Pronoun Card Number One, which was a reappropriation of Adrienne Piper's My Calling Card Number One. So through critique and through conversation with my peers, it was kind of, it was brought to my attention more so I was, you know, thought critically about me as a white non-binary artist taking a work which My Pronoun Card Number One was a card that Adrienne Piper would give to folks to kind of, especially in situations where they may, or the audience or the person, especially said maybe something racist or problematic, as Adrienne Piper was a, you know, in some situations, a white passing Black person. So essentially I took this card and kind of used this almost the exact same form to think about a way to lessen the emotional labor of talking about pronouns when someone's misgendered. So kind of through this process, I realized, you know, as a white artist taking this work that was so rooted in Blackness and without even thinking twice about, you know, repurposing this for my kind of needs and my, you know, project was, you know, was problematic, and kind of wanting to speak to that and take a small amount of accountability for what that means for me to do that. So I essentially, you know, wrote this essay and responded to this. The slides are going kind of slow, so bear with me with that too. And also not to talk about this project too much, as there's a lot to go through. It was interesting too, like first posting this, you know, project on Instagram and kind of having a lot of people wanting, because I was eventually first off giving this, you know, free to folks to use, you know, wasn't trying to make money off this by any means. But, you know, kind of when I was investigating and posted kind of a second post being like, these are some of my new like understandings of this project, like there was a lot of engagement by a lot of the other white folks that were so easy to embrace this, and also were saying things like, I don't know what you did wrong, like you didn't do anything wrong, and, you know, trying to be like, it's not, you know, this easy binary of right and wrong, and really just wanting to embrace my, you know, impulse to so easily, you know, repurpose something that I shouldn't have. And just in this first anthology, there is such generous, you know, contributions by amazing artists such as American Artists, which they reworked and kind of responded to a work that they did called Failure and Markup, remembering Sandra Bland. So it's an AI work that American Artists did a couple years ago called Sandy Speaks. So they really, which I can't speak to you, I mean, really read this if you have the chance to. And also I just want to note, anyone who wants to read either of these anthologies but doesn't have the means to afford a physical copy, just email me and I can send you a free copy of either publication. But this is just really impactful, where they really looked at kind of the failure of this work they created using AI technology and surveillance of Black bodies, kind of really talking about failure on so many levels, but really just the failure to really speak to what they wanted to in the original work. And it was just so generous, and I just love their work so much. One second. The computer sometimes hates going to the next slide. Oh, there we go, click. And then I also want to read a passage from, so one of the foundational texts for this first anthology was Sick Woman Theory by Joanna Hedlund. I just want to read a short passage that I think really speaks to what we're talking about, or what I want to talk about with the fellow contributors today too, and just really speaks to this first anthology. Sick Woman Theory is for those who are faced with their vulnerability and unbearable fragility every day, and so have to fight for their experience, not only honored, but first made visible. For those who, in Audre Lorde's words, were never meant to survive because the world was built against their survival. It's for my fellow Spoonies, my fellow Sick and Crip crew. You know who you are, even if you're not being attached to a diagnosis. For one of the aims of Sick Woman Theory is to resist the notion that one needs to be legitimized by any institution so that they can be so that they can try to fix you according to their terms. You don't need to be fixed, my queens. It's a world that needs the fixing. So kind of rereading some passages for this talk today, that really struck me with what kind of this first anthology and just some of what I'm getting at, especially talking about the failure of institutions and creating our own. So this brings me to the second anthology, which Lily kind of spoke to this at the beginning too. This first started in, I started thinking about this when I was making the first one. So January of 2019 is when I first kind of thought about it. And I think I even contacted the first group of contributors, which these final contributors, many of whom are in attendance or for this panel, this final list is really different than the first list. And that kind of goes with running this project by myself. You know, this book was made without a budget, and I kind of wanted to show some of the production of this project as well too. Like, it was all made, the entire thing was designed, edited, I contacted all the artists, like everything was done just by me. And the main reason for that was just, I didn't have a budget and, you know, to make this affordable and also to be able to pay every single contributor at least $150. So this is, you know, money that was out of, you know, my own pocket, which, you know, I'm thankful also to have, you know, gotten to a place where I do live off of GenderFail, which, so it is, you know, from the project itself too, but it's, you know, so wonderful to be able to pay everyone and to do all this immense labor by myself, which is, you know, in thinking about this book, a really, really, really important part of this is the labor that was put into it. And I also want to call out the amazing projects that helped me print this, Textbooks in Brooklyn, Irrelevant Press, I went to Small Editions. There's one more that I went to, I think. Or maybe it's just the three. I might be missing another one, but I was basically lugging all this paper around to so many different places. I think it was like 20 plus hours of printing in total. And I just also wanted to show, this is an image from making the first anthology as well too, that was created during a residency that I did at Wendy's Subway. And also just quickly, I know I'm kind of running over the time limit that I have. I just want to talk a little bit about some of the design things that I have in the book. So in a lot of the design, you can kind of see, you know, some of these irregular or non-conventionally designed typefaces. So what's used in the G, the F, and all the kind of the capital letters for all those were made from these typefaces that I've been making based off of protest signs. And two in particular that were used in this anthology were the ACT UP protest font, where I sourced a bunch of different images from the ACT UP movement of the late 80s, early 90s. And, you know, I think some of the images of today, from today too. So, you know, really just, so I take, you know, these vernacular handmade signs and, you know, form this into a typeface. And the main reason to, you know, to really honor this movement every time it's used. So essentially anytime I or another designer would use this, they would be confronted with, you know, the even just the term ACT UP protest font too, and just kind of a, it's also a celebration and remembrance of this mm-hmm. event. And here are some of the documentation that I used for the event, from the event series. And then I quickly want to talk about the most recent one that I made, which was from the Black Trans Lives Matter typeface. And I'm really running over here. So it was made from a singular protest event on June 14th at the Brooklyn Museum, where almost 20,000 people gathered in support of Black Trans Lives, which was such a powerful event, and using protest signs from that event. And in particular, one from Public Assistance, which is this amazing new project here in Brooklyn that is this multifaceted space. So it was really great kind of posting this poster after the fact and having, you know, I was connected through social media to this amazing project. So definitely look them up if you don't know about them already. And then kind of getting to reading a small passage from here, which I didn't really leave as much time to talk about this book, but I, in preparing for this event, I really kind of wanted to define what a failed state is. So I, you know, don't talk to this as much in the forward defining a failed state, but this is in a lot of ways what a failed state I'm referring to in this publication. And then I will read a short passage from the section in the forward, Failing to React, Reacting to Failure. In terms of this project, failure does not seek to endlessly prolong the binary of failure or success that is inherent to Western culture. To clarify, we do not wish to let this failure success paradigm limit how we speak to our creative out, the creative output of our projects. At the same time, however, we must acknowledge the very real consequences of white supremacy, colonialism, heteronormativity, the lack of healthcare access and other forms of oppression, such that the binaries of these systems still brutally exist for many people. This publication is not a utopian project on failure, but an investigation on how our projects work within the real obstacles. World obstacles we are working to dismantle and rebuild. Each of the projects in this anthology are providing forms of resistance, support, and alternatives to the institution that failed to provide us with what we need to live, thrive, and overcome. The work presented in this anthology is a very real, very felt aspect of our daily lives, especially dependent on the background one comes from. This cannot simply be theorized away. And also in writing this anthology, since it happened through so many different aspects of the last 2 years, I also included different kind of writings in progress, besides being copy edited slightly exactly kind of as they were written during these times. So written in December of 2018, March of 2020, and also June of 2020 as well too. So even through that short period of time through the, you know, uprising for Black liberation, especially through the death of George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, and this endless list of names. So much have changed through that. And then just kind of want to show a few different slides from some projects that aren't here today that also encourage part of it, especially Decolonize This Place, which in December 2018, their protests against the Whitney Museum was a really powerful action that really inspired this anthology in its early stages. So it was really amazing to have them. And also Thank God for Abortion, which I think I'm going over time a little bit, but I do want to read a small passage from them because I just love their essay so much. The founder, Viva, sent me this, I think they had wrote it or finished it right after a long trip. So I think they wrote this amazing essay, Lose and Win Everything, really late at night. And the text itself feels so urgent and so incredible. And which I'll show later, I'm wearing my Thank God for Abortion shirt today. Thank God for Abortion is queer as fuck. Catch the white gays asking over and over why we stay at Pride. Cause we can get pregnant. Queer, gay people, trans people, men, women, gender non-binary people, all kinds of us can get pregnant. All you need is a user is for Christ's sakes and some seedmen that could be any gender and sexuality. These binaries aren't real, or they are real within magnitudes. Catch it. Bigger, more expansive. Are we ready for paradise? That's what will happen when Black trans lives matter to everyone. We are failing. We are failing and we must all do better. Strive every day for the good of all. We have to see we are failing so that we can keep from failing. We are late. Don't you want to live in paradise? And I think I will end my presentation right there with those powerful words. I also wanted to read this from Career Archive work, which I think Paul is in the audience, but I'll just leave this up for a second as I try to exit. Yeah, I'll stop sharing my screen now. I almost left the Zoom call. That wouldn't have been good. I think I did stop sharing. Wait, am I still sharing? No, okay, great. Okay, I did stop sharing, great. and then the next person up is Kira. Yes, go for it.
Thank you so much, Bea and Lily and Q and all of the fellow panelists. The work that everyone is doing is really inspiring and amazing, and I'm just really thankful to be part of this discussion today and thankful for everybody who's taking time out of their evening or wherever, whatever time it is where you are to join us. So thank you. My name is Kira Wisniewski. My pronouns are she, her. I'm located on the land of Piscataway people, also known as Baltimore City, and I have the distinct honor to serve as executive director of Art and Feminism. I want to recognize that my title might sound a little fancy, but really I get to work with an international leadership team that works collectively and collaboratively. Art and Feminism is something that started as a passion project in 2014 and has really grown organically into an official nonprofit organization. So just because this is something that we try to normalize in all of our meetings, I wanted to share briefly our Brave Friendly Space Agreement. You can read the full version I'll drop this link in the chat. But we like to start all of our sessions in this way. So the goal of this session is to create an encouraging space for collective learning. This requires intentional behavior wherein participants are conscious of and accountable for the effect of their statements and actions on others. We respect our experiences and the experiences of others and recognize that we can't do this work without one another. We agree to hold each other accountable to foster a brave, friendly space. Okay, so here's the situation. Wikipedia's gender trouble is well documented. In 2011 survey, which I know that's a little dated, but it's the most recent data that they have, the Wikimedia Foundation found that less than 10% of all contributors identify as women. More recent research puts that number a little closer to 16% globally, but that's still quite a disparity. Further, that same year, the New York Times reported that the data analysis tools and linguistic studies concluded that Wikipedia has fewer and less extensive articles on women. So those same tools have also shown gender biases in biographical articles. So in other words, the articles and biographies about women are way shorter and way less complete than those of male folks on Wikipedia. So this might all sound super niche, right? We're working on Wikipedia. That sounds pretty specific, and it is. But the fact of the matter is that Wikipedia is the 10th most visited website in the world. Search engines like Google, your smart devices in your home, and even big institutions like the Museum of Modern Art all scrape Wiki for data. So when there are absences on Wikipedia, they echo throughout the entire internet. But before we even get to Wikipedia, women are already at a disadvantage in the art world. Cis and trans women, non-binary people, people of color are also all underrepresented in the art world. And here are some really nice infographics from the National Museum of Women in the Arts, just kind of showing that in major US museums, 87% are men, 85% of them are white. And then in Janssen's Basic History of Western Art, 8% of the 300 plus artists are women and only less than 1% are women of color. And over 60% of MFAs are women, but galleries only show about 30%. So there's already a lot of issues before we even get to Wiki. So when cis and trans women, non-binary people, and BIPOC communities are not represented in the writing and editing of the 10th most visited site in the world, information about people like us gets skewed and misrepresented. And the stories get mistold, and we lose out on the real history. And that's why we're here, to change that. Art and Feminism is an international community that strives to close the information gap about gender, feminism, and the arts on the internet. We envision dismantling supremacist systems and creating pathways for everyone to participate in writing and writing history. So from coffee shops and community centers to largest museums and universities in the world, Art and Feminism leads a do-it-yourself and do-it-with-others campaign that teaches people of all gender identities and expressions to edit Wikipedia. Informed by critical pedagogy and intersectional feminist organizing principles, Art and Feminism mobilizes, trains, and supports a growing global community that collectively creates and updates articles on Wikipedia, adds images to the Wikimedia Commons, and expands Wikidata entries and more. And whereas Art and Feminism events can happen year round, they typically are concentrated in March around International Women's Day. And despite this year, well, being this year, in 2020, we celebrated Art and Feminism events in 6 continents, 27 countries, and 20 different languages. And since 2014, when this project was started, over 18,000 people at more than 1,260 events around the world have participated in our editathons, resulting in the creation or improvement of more than 84,000 articles on Wikipedia and the sister projects. I do want to acknowledge that Art and Feminism is not the only Wiki affiliate organization doing this work. There are projects that we aren't even the only project that's just focusing on art. There are other projects doing that as well. There are also groups that focus on topics of marginalized communities in the field of science and sports and other, pretty much every topic. So there are some other great orgs that you might be interested in learning more about: Black Lunch Table, Afro Crowd, Whose Knowledge, and Women in Red. So we're in great company. Our tools have beginners in mind, and we're ready for you to become an editor and join us in our quest for information activism. So thank you.
Is it my turn? Yeah, cool. If at any point you can't hear me or my connection gets blurred, just send a message in the chat. We'll keep it casual. My name is Shawn Escarciga. I'm the founder and the co-organizer of the NYC Low Income Artist and Freelancer Relief Fund, which is co-organized with Nadia Tucholska. And before I go any further, I want to make it very clear that this was a joint effort. We were attached at the hip, and I could not have done anything without Nadia. And I also want to acknowledge B and Q for inviting this project into the mix. It's been such an honor, and I'm very honored to be sharing space with this panel. So that being said, the fund was started in March, just at the cusp of the major shutdowns in New York City. And it really was a fluke. I had just lost some freelance gigs and was very scared. And we were at a point very similar to where we are now, where the government wasn't doing anything. No one was taking it seriously. No one really had savings or a backup plan. And so I began reaching out to friends, and as an artist, was concerned, a very low-income artist was very concerned for my other friends like me, especially my Black and queer and or queer and or Indigenous and or disabled artist friends that I knew would be suffering from what was about to happen. And a friend of mine turned me onto the work being done in Seattle by Ijeoma Oluo, who had at that point raised about $70,000 for artists in Seattle. And the model that she came up with was little to no barrier for entry. If you were an artist living in Seattle, you could apply for funds and they would get you funds as quickly as possible. So that's something that I put into the fund. It was a GoFundMe campaign, and it kind of exploded over the course of a few days. This was something I was initially thinking was going to be maybe $5,000 that we could share with the performance art community that I'm a part of in Brooklyn. But by the weekend, this was on a Wednesday when it started, by the weekend we'd raised about $20,000, and it was going up about $5,000 a day as the word got out, because people were starting to understand the severity of what was happening in New York. And Nadia hopped in and saved my goddamn life, and we really just began trucking from there. To date, we've raised about $250,000 and paid out to about 1,000 plus people in New York City. Our only stipulation was that you identify as being in need and you give us a way to pay you that is accurate. and aside from that, we were pretty much happy to let you have the money. I was very inspired by this notion of failure, because this project came out of very much the failed state that we were living in, but it very much felt like a messy thing that a scrappy artist was doing with another scrappy artist. And we had no idea what we were doing when we started to reach the 50,000K mark, and executive directors from foundations were reaching out asking us how we were doing this. And we were really unsure. it was a big awakening to why more people aren't doing this. And I think, or why foundations aren't aware that more people are doing this, really. And really pushing foundations to really listen to smaller entities, smaller individuals, smaller artists, and let them know that sitting on hundreds of thousands of dollars is not the way to go, and that a barrier to entry is not the way to go, that if someone expresses need, especially in the middle of a global pandemic, you address that need if you have the capability to do so. And that's what we strove to do. We, as two white organizers, very much recognized our privilege in this endeavor. And so we initially just opened up a survey to as many people as wanted to apply. And when 500 people applied in 2 days, we had to shut that down. And we decided that we were going to pay everyone $150 because that's what we could do within our means. And we managed to do that. And we kind of triaged in our little Excel sheet, you know, who identified as having urgent medical needs, who identified as BIPOC, who identified as being having emergency living situations, who was disabled, who was an undocumented immigrant, who was not going to receive a stimulus check, and these various, you know, identifiers that people were sharing with us. And we just kept going. We funded about 7 rounds, and we had a cohort of artists that, a cohort of organizations. Dance NYC was a foundation, the Indie Theater Fund was a foundation, NYFA joined us briefly, and another grassroots fund, the Dance Union, which is two Black artists who were primarily looking to fund undocumented and disabled dancers who identified as BIPOC. And we pulled our resources both monetarily and intellectually and tried to make sure that no one slipped through the cracks. And I don't know, we didn't know what we were doing. No, I don't think anyone knew. It literally was a day by day process. So we have done our best, and, you know, we met with Ted Kerr, who I think the HIV Howler folks might be familiar with, who runs What Would an HIV Doula Do? And he was very interested in our process of letting this thing run its course and shifting the nature of the work elsewhere. And that's something that with mutual aid, we've really been thinking a lot about, that it's our responsibility to our communities to keep our communities afloat, but it's not our sole response. Like, we are not the only people that should be keeping our communities afloat, and we should be keeping institutions and the government accountable as well. And who do we pass the torch on to when you experience massive burnout? I think I will leave it there. Thank you.
Okay, I'm just unmuting myself. I think that means that I'm up. Thank you, everyone. I thought we were gonna get into some juicy stuff, and it is just already like fully juiced. So this is really awesome. I'm just gonna share my screen right away. And
hi, my name is Jessica Whitbread. I'm an artist and activist, and I'm currently joining you from Bulgaria.
Hi, I'm Anthea Black. I'm calling from Oakland, California. And together, Jessica and I are the publishers and co-editors of the HIV Howler Transmitting Art and Activism.
So the HIV Howler is an art publication that we do together. As co-editors, as girlfriends, lovers,
for 8 years.
8 years, 8 years. if we were there, we'd be celebrating together. And we, what we do is try to amplify the voices of artists living with HIV from all around the world.
So the paper really springs from this collaboration and the love that we share and have for community. And Jessica's work as an international global advocate, and my work as an artist publisher. And we work with a global advisory of many amazing, talented artists, writers, and cultural producers to help us to guide the themes and do outreach around the content of the paper. And each issue of the paper features a thematic pairing and an editorial. And we intermix archival documents and work by artists, writers, and activists living with HIV. And one of our goals is to really counteract the kind of failed narrative of one-dimensional HIV, or that there's a single experience, but to create a context where artists, activists can have deeper nuance about living with HIV over a long stretch of time, and also across many different life experiences and geographical registers. So we curate conversations by artists. This one is Nancer Lemoines and Fred Weston. And our thematic pairings are really important because they allow for that disruption of the one-dimensional image of what it means to live with HIV. Mm-hmm. This is a conversation with Charles Ryan Long and Michaela Serino, a piece by the amazing Marcus Borton from Philadelphia in our Mentor Mother issue, a conversation with Chiron Liu and Manuel Solano in our Sex and Pleasure issue, and our most recent issue, Movement Migration. And at the moment, we're just getting ready to launch our newest issue, which is about time and money. This is an example of extending the paper into the exhibition space and really bringing it back to the foundation of Jessica's work as a global activist and bringing people together in the very amazing way for conversations and dialogue. And this took place at Printed Matter last year, which was actually the last time that we saw each other in person. But this space of intimacy and connection is really, really important, working from an ethic of care and love rather than a question of gatekeeping or structures that sort of keep people apart or keep people out of community.
So we were so excited when Bea asked us to be part of GenderFail and to give this contribution.
And I'm just gonna pause it and advance for a second. Jessica and I tend to really chat a lot. So now we're gonna skip ahead a little bit.
Actually wanted to talk about, the financial inequities that exist within the art and especially like HIV intersections.
And in the conversation, we kind of talk about burnout and financial stress, and particularly the expectation that artists work for free and that pause people within the movement volunteer their time. And we want to zero in on one particular moment in the conversation, which was when I bring up this really amazing piece that Jessica made.
Yeah, so Fuck Positive Women, I worked with amazing artist Allison Mitchell from Toronto to create this piece to talk about a narrative that no one ever talks about, which is women living with HIV like to have sex, we like to fuck, we are sexual beings. This was postered about 3,000 all over Toronto and really changed some of the dialogue and opened up some questions. what we wanted to also build on was, yeah, you can fuck us. You can also pay us, pay pause women as well, pay artists. And so this is where our issue, our next.
And then we'll go to this one.
So, so we were also thinking about fuck positive women. And you know what else you can also do? You can also pay pause women. You can pay artists and none of this bullshit. Maikiki wrote this excellent piece, Your Arts Informed Research is Killing Me, about culture production and artists being used within the research and HIV response. And if you actually want to work with artists, you need to pay them.
And those two kind of conversations are what we really wanted to frame today as a failed state, which is that we expect artists to work for free and we expect pause people to volunteer for the movement without compensating them for their labor. And so this has led us to kind of springboard from the conversation we had for the GenderFail anthology to think more deeply about wage equity for artists living with HIV and how arts organizations can continue to dismantle structures of gatekeeping by paying artists for their labor and recognizing that pause artists in particular should not be called on to provide free labor. And so we're in the middle of this wage survey for artists, and we would love to invite any pause artists who are watching today to check us out on Instagram and fill out the survey in our link. And hopefully some of these questions around wage equity can come up in the conversation. We're releasing our new issue in just a few weeks. And so folks can also get in touch to get their hands on the new issue.
And I just wanted to also add this. Subscriptions are free for people living with HIV. If you aren't, you can for sure make a donation. We really, really appreciate donations, especially that allow us to send small parcels to areas that don't have access. And for some of our artists to give out 50 papers within their community. So that's really helpful. So yeah, find us and donate, get your own subscription. Thanks. Share. Okay, bye.
Good night to Jessica in Bulgaria.
That's why I'm not here. It's late. It's late.
We're going to go on with the conversation.
Thanks. Bye.
Okay, so I'll stop there.
I think that was very long, but
and now is where Jessica says that we went over time. So thank you, and I look forward to some more chatting.
Wow, 50 of you showed up here on a Thursday night. That is incredible. I want to start by thanking everyone who spoke before me for being here and for the work that they do. I want to thank Q for paying me to be here. And I want to thank B for creating this foundation of building on failed states, because you can't build a survivable future on land where there were slaves. So I think it's really important to start there. My name is Kamra. I use they, them pronouns. I am a transgender Black American living on Munsee Lenape territory, AKA Brooklyn. I am also the founder of Activation Residency. So let me go ahead and share my screen so we can get into it. Is my screen visible? Great, okay. So I'm just gonna start by reading about the project. So Activation Residency is a Black trans-led artist residency experiment aiming to generate safer and more collaborative space, adapt to its residents' needs, and create portals to futures needed now. Located in New York State's Southern Catskill Mountains of Wood Ridge, the residency seeks to activate the creative practice of each participating resident, redistribute access, resources, and care, and experiment with the means of production. Activation Residency was founded in 2018 by futurity artist me in response to the lack of creative and healing opportunities available to Black and Brown, trans and queer artists, activists, and community members. Kamra moved to New York in 2016 and quickly discovered they needed equitable creative healing space centering Black trans people. They asked 20 of their artist friends to participate in a small residency experiment fall 2018. Their friends agreed, enjoyed 3 magical days at the Outlier Inn, then spent the next year expanding their portfolios, pursuing creative endeavors, and activating their deepest dreams and desires. In 2019, Activation Residency hosted 60 artists at the Outlier Inn for a healing justice seminar. These artists deepen their transformative justice praxis and develop pods to help them hold themselves accountable beyond the seminar. In 2020, Activation Residency launched Activation Co-op Fund, Respite is Resistance, Dome Gallery, the Activation Residency Shop, and Farming Futurity. Each initiative exists as a counter gesture and opportunity to return creation to Black people. Activation Residency headquarters via Farming Futurity will open September 2021. So now I'm gonna switch over to my PowerPoint. I can't see anyone right now, so can someone give me like a vocal? I can see the PowerPoint.
Oh yeah, we can see it.
Okay, beautiful. Okay, so I moved to New York in 2016. And actually I wanna start with the backstory. I've been an overperformer my whole life, and I graduated from Arizona State University with an undergraduate degree in global studies. From there, I was recruited by the State Department to serve as a foreign service officer. And they gave me a full ride scholarship to New York University, which is how I found myself in New York in the first place. After a year of grad school, the FBI did a background investigation on me because it's one of the requirements for being a diplomat. And after finding out that I had consumed mushrooms in my undergraduate degree and also had a poor financial record, they revoked my scholarship and also took away my opportunity to serve as a diplomat. So this is just one example of how the state specifically continues to fail Black trans people. And so I was put in a position to have to create my life and my career from scratch. And that's how Activation Residency was born. It is a very scrappy project. Activation Residency has no funding. And the only reason why this project exists is because I had to find alternative ways to survive outside of institutions by creating my own space. So one of the things I'm most proud of is this year, I went to my first protest in Flatbush the weekend after George Floyd was murdered. And I was in Flatbush, marching down Ocean Ave, chanting Black Lives Matter, Black Lives Matter. And it was in that moment that I sort of stepped outside of my body and was like, wow, it's 2018 or it's 2020. I'm a Black American in the streets screaming that my life matters. And I just fell down to the ground in tears. It was almost like my ancestors were calling to me in that moment, being like, we've done this before, we've been here before. And so after that moment, I just had this epiphany that we need change, we need to do something different. And one of the things I realized that is that from political and movement organizing, care was missing. I didn't see care. People were marching and they were dehydrated. There weren't enough medics on the street. And so I thought that my place in the revolution is to insert care. So that weekend after my first protest, I designed Respite as Resistance, which was 5 weeks of respite experiences for Black and Brown, trans and queer activists and frontliners who are marching, protesting, creating community fridges and all of the other works that we've been talking about in this discussion so far. I posted this project on IG and within 3 weeks raised $50,000 to be able to provide these respite experiences for 50 frontliners. We had 10 frontliners at each weekend. Everybody got paid, everybody got fed, everybody got COVID tested. And we did a really good job at making sure that everybody was safe and experienced the respite that they needed. So all of the pictures that you see here in my slideshow are from that experience that happened back in September through October. Activation has since then sort of like blown up, and Activation Residency is an LLC. It's a single member LLC. So it's the way that I make money and pay my collaborators. I also launched Activation Co-op Fund, which is a financial cooperative. It's registered with the state as an LTD, which means that it's a cooperative and every member has equal shares. B is actually one of our members. Check it out, it's great. It's been up since April. We have about $5,400 in our collective fund, and anyone who is a member has access to those funds by submitting a proposal and having the rest of the members either vote the proposal up or down. So it's a way for folks to get access to money quickly without having to jump through all of the logistical hoops of getting the support that you need. I also launched the Activation Residency Shop this year. Our first product is Consent and Boundaries for the Revolution, which is a Zoom course for white people, and it educates them on how to somatically prepare for receiving feedback, as well as deactivating their white fragility. One of my really close friends who is an intimacy coordinator, their name is Mia, and they run that course. So Activation has now sprouted into this beautiful ecosystem of all of my great ideas. Activation Co-op Fund and Dome Gallery, they're both community projects that I help other artists put together. Dome Gallery is a gallery where artists curate their own shows, whether they're photographers, painters, and it's live on our website for folks to view and also buy their work. And then all of the rest of the projects that you see mapped out are either live products that I've already built or products that I hope to build with our up and coming program, Farming Futurity, that will be launching next year. So these are some of the cool things that people have said about Activation Residency. Willie Norris, who has a t-shirt brand, said, "I love Activation Residency and everything they do." And Supermaker, they said that Activation Residency has come to represent a future in which mutual aid efforts center accessible care and creative expansion through community solidarity. The why for this project, there's a few. Based on my experience there and the experience is that I've heard of other artists, there is no space like it. It is this particular season that we did of Respite as Resistance. It was specifically designed for people to rest and lay down and seek the comfort and the joys that they need, which is something that a lot of the frontliners hadn't done up until that moment. Activation Residency does many things and has a reparations culture. So we're not shy about demanding reparations and redistributing funds. Every Zodiac season, we redistribute 25% of our Activation Co-op Fund membership contributions to any Black trans person out there on the internet who DMs us on Instagram. It is Black trans owned, so I own Activation Residency LLC outright. We believe in care before impact. So for me, that looks like taking breaks, slowing down, turning off my Zoom camera when I need to, and all of these things lead up to being able to have the capacity to have an impact. So if we're showing up to the work not fully cared for, we can't have an incredible impact because of what Shawn said about burnout and all of these other things that can come up. And it's caretakers caring for caretakers. Okay, so the impact that we've had. Activation Residency has served 130 artists and community members since 2018. This year, the project kind of exploded and we now have over 11,000 followers on Instagram. And the residency is impactful because it serves an intersectional audience and is sturdy in its DIY approach to care. So even though I have gone legal with the project, it still has this very scrappy DIY nature about it. And what I mean by that is even when I'm on site working, I still have moments where my care is prioritized and where I get to enjoy the sauna or the hot tub or jump in the pond. And that's my favorite part about Activation is that it really pushes back against industry. So some of the innovative things about my project, it's a space for Black trans people by a Black trans person. Residents decide what care looks like for them 24/7. So one of the things about like institutions and structure is that you do need frameworks to help people navigate. However, one of the unique things about Activation Residency is that at the beginning of each residency, we have community town halls where everyone gets to be honest and vulnerable about what their access needs are and what they need to navigate the space in a way that feels safest for them, which means that every residency experience is going to look different. And you can't plan for that. And so it feels really good to be able to foster a space that is safe enough for experimentation to happen as it needs to. Activation Residency is one of the most coveted non-industry spaces. And I say that because when spaces grow, there tends to be this corporatization that happens. And while I am experiencing Activation grow its budget and its audienceship, I won't ever sell out to corporations. Activation Residency is an overnight residency and thus a nightlife experience is possible. So one of the things I really loved about this residency experience this year was that if somebody wanted a midnight sauna moment, they could have that. If somebody wanted a 2 a.m. s'mores moment, they could have that. And so it was really interesting to see the residency shift from just being an artist residency to being a complete space that had a daytime experience as well as a nightlife experience. This is a photo of one of our healers doing Laho Chi on a frontliner. And Laho Chi is an energy practice. It's in the same realm as Reiki inside of our geodesic dome. So in this residency experience, not only did we provide folks with the opportunity to rest and restore, but we also brought in practitioners to work on them, whether it be working through trauma in the body or just helping them release whatever they were going through. Here are a few awesome photos of me resting at the residency. There's hammocks everywhere, there's lounge chairs everywhere. The space is really designed for rest and comfort. And these are just a few testimonials from some of our frontliners. I'm gonna read this top one from Lila. Lila says, "From the bottom of my heart, I will always remember my time at Activation Residency. I'm full of gratitude for the subtle yet profound and healing transformations I was blessed with through this experience. I have to say, I was not expecting just how transformative it truly was. A synchronous manifestation, my being was not fully prepared to receive the sheer volume of wisdom, insight, power, beauty, and pure love that this program embodies." I am going to stop my share there. And yeah, I guess my final thoughts are that while this work looks glamorous and fun. A lot of folks who do DIY projects, actually I'll speak for myself. I did a DIY project because I had to. It was based on survival. And so yeah, I'll end there and I'm excited to jump into conversation and answer any questions.
Thank you so much. Thank you all so much. And I even just want to, before we get into this, just someone had this comment which was true and funny, like, hey, I thought we were going to talk about failure. These are all great successes. And I think that's like such a great kind of thing to say, because, or to mention here, is that, you know, getting to these points, which, you know, so many of our projects are or have been at, is, you know, is steeped in, especially in its creation, in such great failure, you know, like such immense, you know, things that, you know, we're trying to make in spite of, you know, and it is great that, you know, we are powerful and we are able to make these really ambitious things in our own way. And especially like, Kamra, having you a part of this conversation is so important because of like what we're fighting for, you know, and I think, you know, and this is such a amazing example. And I'll just kick off the conversation with something that I, you know, one of the many things I've learned from you is changing terminology to talking about investment rather than just donating. And I would love to hear you just talk about that more, because especially whenever I post, it's like, I, you know, that terminology has stayed with me and I, you know, try to share that as much as possible. It's like, you know, and as someone who often, and, you know, and also I want to kind of make sure I mention about the book too, because this is in part of release, but I think I said 25%, but you know, I've been donating more because sales have been slow anyway, but 50% of the sales of this book that we're, you know, that this is kind of a part of will be invested in Activation Residency. And I mean, maybe for the rest of the edition, I was going to change it, but you know, I think really I'm just, you know, I mean, I donate on top of, or invest in so many different other projects in any way. So yeah, I think throughout the edition, or for the rest of the edition, that will continue to happen. Maybe not always 50%, but at least 25%. But anyway, so I just wanna drop a link for that before we get into conversation, just because I think, you know, as people, this is going over time and want to make sure that, you know, people leave when they need to, you know, so I just wanted to mention that first. But yeah, just to start off the conversation. So there's just a link to that. And I also dropped a link to invest directly in Activation as well too. So, you know, skip the book and just put your money there. But yeah, I would love for you to talk about that terminology, because it's so important. It's changed the way so I would love for you to talk about
that. Yeah, absolutely. Thank you for that question. It's so good. And it's one I've gotten a lot this past year. Honestly, fuck donations. Like, nobody should be getting a cookie or feeling good about themselves for redistributing wealth. Investing in Black trans futures is just the bottom line. And I think that we're not gonna see the government push reparations forward. And so we need to be the culture that is gonna do that on our own. And so right after Respita's Resistance was funded, I started a project, Farming Food Charity. And basically what I'm gonna do with that project is buy 15 acres of land and build an artist residency. And also start a permaculture farm so I can do CSA for communities that need it most. So it's an investment. You're investing in a future that is more survivable for people who look like me, for people who are more marginalized than me. I think that folks are really good at clocking like who is more privileged than them, but nobody wants to clock who's more disadvantaged or less privileged than them. And so it's really important to be thinking about your positionality in a spectrum and not just this like hierarchy. And yeah, I think that because Activation hasn't received investments from, we did receive one $50,000 investment from an artist named Anna who auctioned off her work to two galleries. And that was the biggest, see, it's like in my brain, I need it to go. The biggest investment that we got, but it's a part of using language to change the culture. And because of, I honestly think it's partially because of the language that we've been able to raise so much money. So after Respita's Resistance was funded, I started raising money for Farming Food Charity. And since I want to say September or early September, late August, we've raised $130,000 for Farming Food Charity. And that project has a $750,000 goal. So there's still a long way to go. But yeah, it's really about taking matters into our own hands. I'm not going to wait for the government to give me my coin or my survival or my livability. Kamra, could you talk about doing, my pronouns are they, them, please don't misgender me, project on my own rather than as a team sounds challenging. Yeah, it sounds challenging, but again, I'm a Black person living in America, being alive is challenging. And so I feel like I've always, this is, finding my own way has always been a part of my life. It isn't something that I just like woke up one day and was like, I'm gonna do this cute little project. And so resilience is built into me. And also I have a lot of collaborators. So I do have folks that I'll pay to come teach a workshop. Like for example, in 2019, we had Trisha Hershey from the NAP ministry come and do a NAP installation at Activation, which was fucking incredible. We also had Manachi do a decolonizing nonviolent communication workshop, which was chef's kiss. And so a lot of the artists that we serve don't have access to programming like this. So it's really, I see myself as an access point. If I have access to something or if I have specific means, I feel like it's my duty to absorb those means and then shift them to wherever they need to be shifted to.
And just jumping off that too, just even one thing that I was kind of writing down that I kind of see through everything too, it's like also not needing to, you know, fully understand what we're doing. So it's like kind of like challenging this idea of mastery, you know, also it's like, you know, we do it because we have to. Like also with me, I've never been good at even applying for anything. So it's like, I'm, you know, going to use what I know to create, you know, the projects that even this book, it's like, it's not a perfectly made object. And it's, you know, when you hold this or even in this, and also this will go into a question, but it's like, it's not about perfection. It's never about perfection. It's about, you know, using whatever I have access to make it happen. And then of course, you know, like with such a good point, it's like this access of privileges too. It's like knowing that, you know, being in these situations and checking that as much as possible. But this is getting to a question for everyone, you know, really just to think about, and even talking about, yeah, so let's just talk about mastery. Okay, anyone else too? You know, it's like kind of doing things out of urgency, necessity,
it's like the building the plane as you're flying it moment, yeah. You know? I've been literally fired from every single neoliberal institution I've ever been a part of. Mm-hmm. I was fired at Pratt Institute. I was fired from Columbia. Like it was, I'm a high achiever. Like I'm somebody who graduated with degrees and stuff like that. So it just goes to show that like folks who carry marginalized identities have to go the extra mile just to live and breathe. And I'm curious what other artists or other contributors think about this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, I also started this fund out of concern for my community, but also concern for myself. I didn't know what the fuck I was going to do. Like, I had no savings. My parents don't have any money. Like, I'm disabled, I'm queer. Like, what the fuck am I going to do? And I think so often the biggest hurdle to starting something like this was, well, I'm not X, Y, and Z person. Like, I'm not an institution. Why should I do this? And it's because the institutions aren't fucking doing it, you know? And it's because there's so many loopholes and gatekeeping to getting this kind of work done that someone has to do it. And it's over the course of like meeting new people doing this work and seeing what came about after COVID hit the fan, or all the shit with COVID hit the fan like really, really bad in the springtime, seeing that the power is actually in the people that are doing this work and the watching institutions, literally people from the NEA on the phone with us being like, how do you do this? It's like, you're the one with the money. Like,
yeah, it's
what are you doing every day?
And I also want to speak to the fact that like harm is inevitable. It's just, how do we transform that harm? So speaking to like, you know, being inexperienced or like not having mastery or whatever, which is also like a white supremacist construct. It's like, how do we do things as safe as we can and then mitigate the harm that comes up? So for example, one of the ways in which I feel like I caused harm at Activation Residency this year was not providing folks with all of the information that they needed prior. So one of my collaborators felt like they didn't have access to all the information that they needed to navigate the space autonomously. And that was a misstep on my part. But it's better for us to learn those transformations through harm together rather than have to wield ourselves to white supremacist institutions that are gonna cause us harm no matter what. So I think it's also too, like, doing this work means increasing your capacity to engage with the harm that you cause, as well as like learning the skills to mitigate that harm.
So yeah, such an important point. And, you know, even, yeah, that's such an important thing. And also just taking, I'm working on a new essay and kind of talking through just forms of accountability, you know, which is something that I think a lot about too, because it's like, you know, needing, because we're in a society which I think there's, I don't even mean to speak to specifics, can't say that word sometimes, but to lack of accountability is just surrounding us in you know, glaring terms, which I'm not going to bring up, like the you know, there's so many forms of the lack of accountability. So yeah, and also working through it. And, you know, as white people, especially myself, it's like working through white fragility. It's like when this shutting down, when I mess up, you know, just in working through that and just needing, yeah, I'm rambling now, but stressing the importance of that so much. And also, so I just want to even, not to cut this conversation short, like so I think we're going to talk until 7:30, so feel free to keep, you know, questions kind of coming in organic, or just, you know, feel free to put them in the chat if anyone does have a question otherwise.
I do have a question.
Yeah.
Cam, so where do you get the audacity? And like, please understand the base of my question. Where do you go from, you know, having to understand and fight for the value of your life to outright saying like, this is mine, I'm going to do it? What did that process look like for you? And are you expecting that process to look similar for other people? I know that was like four questions, I'm sorry.
No, that's okay. Do you want me to speak to like the beginning of the project and the start?
Yeah. Or do you want me to
speak to more so the like process through what I'm going through now with the project?
The current placement of your project, I think.
Yeah, so COVID hit, I got laid off. I was in my apartment with my two roommates and I had just been broken up with. And the person that broke up with me, when they broke up with me, they told me that they felt pressured into a relationship in the first place. And so that was like, I was like, whoa, like that was like a huge sort of, that was a lot of information. And so for me, I felt like I needed to do what I needed to do to educate myself and to deepen my understanding of myself and how that happened. So I started doing consent and boundary work and also deepening my communication practice. And from there, I just started having meetings with people. I met with a few of the artists that went to Activation last year, and I said, what does Activation look like now? I mean, it's a global pandemic. We can't really meet IRL. So how are we gonna move forward? So from those meetings, I decided to start Activation Co-op Fund, and I was getting unemployment at the time. And so, yeah, to be audacious, I really had no other option. I started Activation Co-op Fund, that kind of took off. And then I think my experience with protesting after George Floyd's murder just really put me in the position to know that this is the work that I want to do. I actually spoke at a protest and I was just like, that's not my work. Like, I really appreciate people who are doing that, but that's just not my work. My work is to center care in the revolution. And I think that the reason why this work has been so successful is because over these past 3 years of being in the activation residency world, I've cultivated really strong relationships of people that believe in the work and want to see the work move forward. So I think for me, my own personal transformation has really informed the work. Like, I couldn't have gotten to this place if I didn't take a step back and look at myself and be like, oh wow, like, I don't know how to set boundaries. Oh wow, like, I say sorry too much. Like, oh wow, my communication is often X, Y, and Z ways. And so I think that my personal transformation has really allowed me to expand like my heart capacity to be able to do this work. And then also too, like, cultivating the support that you need to not get burnout, you know, to not overdo it. While I was doing those 5 weeks of residency programs for artists, I paid $5,000 for a personal coach just to keep my head on straight. And so it's like investing in myself as well. And what was the follow-up question to the audacity piece?
So you actually kind of started touching on it with your consent and boundaries, like, and how you're now giving that information and giving the tools for that audacity to the people who are coming. Mm-hmm. Just because, like, everyone's journey with that looks very different. You know, obviously your process informed how activation looks, but it's not the only process that's informing how that looks. So I guess my question is, like, what does that interface look like? I know the town halls are a part of it, but there have to be constant check-ins, right?
Yes and no. I feel like within the time frames of the project, like, we're really, really in it. So a typical day at Activation Residency, we arrive early, myself and my collaborators, we arrive early in the morning on a Friday. We set up all of the installations. So, like, the water jugs, the furniture, the carpet, the snacks, we just get everything ready. Before the artists arrive, we have a check-in with ourselves and just really sit in what we're going through for that day. We have an amazing lunch before everybody gets there to make sure that we're fueled up. And then we mask up and prepare for our artists to come. And then we meet with the practitioners to do an opening ceremony. So my collaborators change all the time, but this year we had practitioners. We had everybody from, like, death doulas to Reiki masters to acupuncturists to shamanic journeyers. And I love working with spiritual folk because they're really good about, like, bringing us into the present moment. And so all of our collaboration happens in real time. And then what I do to keep the feedback loop going is, after each project, I'll send out, you know, a nice feedback form that makes it really accessible for people to inform me on what their needs are. And the thing I love about the most about the project is that it iterates. So I never really know what it's going to look like until somebody, like, knocks on my door and is like, I want to collaborate. Like, let's do some cool shit. And I'm like, all right, what you got? You know? So, it feels cool to have a structure to be able to play inside. And I think that play has been a really huge theme in activation. Like, how are we making this, you know, enjoyable? How are we opening ourselves up to the possibility of play? And in terms of, like, resource and money and stuff, I've been poor my whole life. My whole life I've been poor. This time last year, I was texting my parents, can you Venmo me $30 for food? So to now have this opposite experience where I have thousands of dollars in the bank account, I've raised over $100,000 for the business. There's a sort of trauma that comes with that quick shift. And so I've also had to do a lot of work around money and how I'm interfacing with it. But now it's, like, become this thing where it's fun. I'm like, how are we gonna make money today, you know? And I think that inserting play and aspects of the work has made it really enjoyable. And another thing that I really love about activation, in terms of your question and what you're speaking to, is I really want to just build a container for other people to come inside and do what they need to do. So there's no real, like, you're coming to my space and this is how it's going to be. It's like, you're coming into the space that I built and what can I do to be of service for you to get your needs met?
Thank you. Thank you for this labor of love. It's very clearly intentional in every aspect of it. And just you walking in your truth outside of that, it's very beautiful to see. And it is changing the way that I and other people are interacting with themselves, especially with the aspect of care. So just thank you. That's not a question, but there you go.
My pleasure. Thank you, Mystic.
I'm so learning so much. And this is, I also just talking about this too, like this, I share this document a lot. Like, I think, and also it's like, as someone else too, that, you know, the way I make my money is by, you know, selling objects, you know, and I'm also, you know, I be now coming from money, I'm always like transparent about that. I always share this document. I keep track of like every single cent that I make in the project and am super transparent about, you know, where the money comes from and also, you know, redistributing as much money as I can afford to without, you know, it's kind of the same thing going into each month. Like, I don't know exactly where my money's gonna come from. So it's like figuring that out month by month, but I just, you know, shared this document where, you know, it doesn't include any of my expenses, which is tens of thousands of dollars after that. But, you know, transparency is such a huge thing. And I think through all this work too, and Shawn too, it's like through that fund, there is so much transparency. And through, you know, all of these projects too, it's like, it's not about making money to make money, but it's we're making money to do something with this. And I just think that's such a powerful kind of theme through all this too. And, you know, and the transparency of just making money in general, because it's like all these institutions and things that have failed us, it's like, they don't want us to know like where this money is going. And I think this is, for my project and for others, this is, you know, such a powerful path forward, is like just letting that be known. You know, it's like and the fact, even like starting everything, whenever I do an artist talk or anything, I always talk about when I'm being paid. It's like, as a moderator, I'm being paid $350 to moderate this thing. Each of the contributors got at least $150 to be here. I think is important things to stress, because if we don't talk about this, you know, just this free labor that Anthea, that you were talking about too, it's like, you know, just the assumption to do things for free. It's I as much as possible try to actively talk to that and dismantle that as much as possible. And I end up doing a lot of things alone, and it's like, and I'll continue to do that. And also it's like, I turn things down too. It's like just saying no, or being like, I can't handle this, so I'm not going to do this. And not, and you know, it is hard in this kind of, and I'm ranting here a little bit because so I want to have one more question, but just like this, willingness to do things for free. It's like social capital, such a tool, you know, that's used against us so often. But yeah, does anyone else, I mean, we only have a few more minutes and I want to be really cautious on time. And I think, you know, the presentations, you know, whenever you plan something, were longer than I intended, but such powerful things were said, and these conversations can continue. It's like whenever we end something like this, it's like, okay, conversation's over, work's over, we're done, pat ourselves on the back, you know, but these conversations will continue. They continue to continue. And, you know, please, you know, I encourage others, invest in Activation Residency, invest in HIV Howler, learn, you know, about Art+Feminism and Wikipedia, because these are, and another thing I wanted to get to that I wasn't able to, it's like asking, you know, it's like Kira, which I mean, you can maybe respond to quickly, but it's like having, I mean, you know, the necessity of you work with a lot of very, you know, doing things at MoMA, you know, working with in Wikipedia, it's like you're interacting with these people so much. But this is just to say that, you know, yeah, I just want to speak to that more, that we don't have time to, but yeah, I'm just ranting. There's a few minutes. Does anyone else want to chime in something? I think otherwise, you know, I think we'll end things here, but I hope everyone, you know, will look up more information, you know, be transparent, invest when you have the means to, please, you know, like this is said throughout this, like it really doesn't matter. I mean, it matters in lots of different ways, but it's like regardless of what happens in the next few months, this money is urgent. You know, we need to check in on our community. We need to invest in our community. You know, this is, you know, this work continues always. Yeah. So Anyone else want to say a final word? Because I'm just going to keep rambling. It is 7:30 now. So any last thoughts from anyone?
Well, I do want to definitely just, you know, ask that as we're talking about the financial piece, that we also consider like what it means to work in a global context, because coming from Canada and now working in the US for the last few years, I recognize like the cultures of paying artists within Canada and the United States, definitely like they have their own history. But the first thing that happens in global work is that fees start getting split. So artists from New York or artists from major centers are used to making a certain amount of money, and people who have control of those budgets start to allocate those resources differently. And one of the things that we try and do with the paper is really to recognize that even though global artists might be coming from different economic structures, that does not mean that from within a North American context, artists who live here get paid more and artists who work in a global context get paid less because of the economic differences. And you know, I think one of the things that Jessica and I often talk about in the HIV response is that there's often this question that there's not enough money to pay people or to do specific projects, but we really want to push back against that and talk about distribution, and that how you distribute resources, and this is, you know, for anybody who holds power, how you distribute resources is a choice. And that choice creates a structural sort of precedent. And that is often a sort of secret code for keeping people out or for sort of stratifying organizations along race lines or along gender lines, or in regards to our work, of course, in relation to people's HIV status. And so, I mean, I think from the insights that we've gained from working outside of North America have really, really thrown that into much sharper relief. And I think that there's obviously lots more to talk about, but I do want to point people, folks who are living with HIV, to our survey. And we've heard from folks in about 15 countries so far. And the data that we're getting is very illuminating that sort of stratification, and something that we're kind of looking at for a future project as well. So thank you, everyone.
B, you're muted.
So I said thank you for reminding me or telling me. I just want to say thank you for bringing that in. That's such a needed like context and talking about this, and reminder of, you know, a non, you know, United States centric kind of conversation that happens, especially living in New York. It's so important, and you know, something that I need to do more and discuss more. And I think, and thank you for bringing that up. And that's, yeah, we're over, there's so much to talk about, but like I said, these conversations will continue, can continue. This is just one moment of also just celebrating all of these amazing projects. And just, that's what this book inherently is about, is like not talking about or over the head about the failures, but what we make within these climates that are not, that do not fund us, do not want our work to succeed, and how, you know, how beautiful this work is, how, it's a celebration of these projects. And I am going to continue and want to do other iterations of this project, as it's, you know, there's so much to be done there. I hate to end this, but I think yes.
Can I say one more thing?
Absolutely.
So abundance thought, ask people how much they want to be paid. That's what I do. I'm like, how much do you want to be paid to show up here? And then also there's a few questions in the chat for me that I can't get to right now, but if you email Kamra@activationresidency.com, I will respond via email.
So important. Yeah.
Thank you so much,
B. Thank you all for being here, I'm at a loss for words, but you know, thank you so much. And again, thank you, Q, for for providing a budget for this. I am so appreciative. And Lily, thank you so much for all your work with this, all the hours that you put into this. And yeah, I do, yeah, have a good night, everyone. The best night that we all can have.
Bye.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night. Bye.